Welcome back, and we are on Enneagram number 8, the Challenger, today. And just as always, there is the notes below and also the link where you can take the test to see which Enneagram you are. So we'll go ahead and dig into the number 8 Challenger Enneagram today. And then our Bible figure that Jason's going to talk about is Samson. And then our Bible reference is 2 Corinthians 12:7-10. So to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. And then, just as always, our purpose today is to better understand the Challenger, their strengths, weaknesses, and communication styles. And the Enneagram Type 8 is called the Challenger. And I know Jason talked about this, I think, a few sessions ago about wings and how in Enneagram they also have wings. So this is actually what my wing is. So I'm a little bit of a Challenger as well. But when I think of the Enneagram Challenger, I specifically think of a friend that I have back in the States. And a lot of times she is just always specifically challenging me to think of the world differently, think of people differently, not be happy with the status quo or becoming complacent. She truly does challenge me. She's someone who is very high justice. She really wants things to be fair. And for especially people who have, just live in circumstances that are difficult, she really has a huge heart to see justice come to those people and to those groups of people. It definitely, like, when I think of a challenger, I picture her. She posts on Instagram a lot about being a challenger, and I just think it's very interesting because, to me, she really does embody a lot of these strengths and also the weaknesses, and is very transparent about kind of showing her as a challenger. So in my mind, that's kind of who I think of when I'm talking about the challenger. They are often described as self-confident, decisive, just, and leader. They have high leadership qualities. Usually, like on a team, they want that leadership role and they kind of thrive in that leadership role. I think sometimes it can be a little bit difficult for like a challenger to be someone who comes alongside or is more like a helper in the situation. That's really hard for them because they often have a lot of ideas. They are, as I just said, decisive, so they can make decisions quickly and confidently. I can make decisions, but they're not usually very confident. But challengers have just this gift of being able to make decisions and then feeling confident with those decisions. So oftentimes, they feel the most comfortable in some sort of like leadership role. But their besetting sin that oftentimes challengers can struggle with is lust, and kind of lust in the sense of similar to like the achiever, but like power and being the best, and they're always kind of wanting more with that they want to be in control, and I think kind of hold on to that control pretty tightly oftentimes, and it's hard for them to kind of not just want more and keep going for more. Different than like the enthusiasts, like we just talked about last time, was that they always are kind of looking for the next like fun and entertaining thing to do. Challengers are kind of like lusting over power or like being in control and some of that like control tendencies. So oftentimes that can be kind of a sin that it's easy for them to fall into and kind of pride within that, that they are the only ones that can accomplish this or do this or make sure that it's done correctly. So I think they have sometimes a hard time kind of like letting go of projects or those kind of things and trusting that other people will help them out in that situation as well. But their kind of underlying emotion that they struggle with is guilt. And I think it kind of closely relates to when we talked about the number three achiever. They have guilt that they're not good enough, or they have guilt that they're not doing enough, or that they have guilt that they're not being the leader that they should be. They have very high expectations for themselves to be a certain way or to accomplish things in a certain way. And so oftentimes I think they could just put that self-guilt onto them. It's not necessarily guilt that they're putting onto other or that other people are putting onto them, but guilt that they're really kind of putting on their own shoulders because they have these expectations that it's just going to, of all the things that they should accomplish and they should be able to do and they should be able to lead in a certain way. And then eights often believe that they must be strong and in control. So kind of what I talked about earlier, they feel like letting their emotions be visible for others can often be hard. They feel like they need to be in control, that they need to lead the meeting, that they want to make the decisions, that they kind of just want to take control of the situation. And so, if they feel strong and in control, I think they feel like they're at their best, but it's kind of hard to let and trust other people to be able to do those things. Jason's going to come up and talk more about like spiritual formation and more about the challenger.
Thank you, Kristen. And I know it's ironic. It's a week later and, we get up and get to school this morning and realize that both Kristen and I had picked out the same outfits that we were wearing last week to wear again today. And so it's just crazy how that works out. So anyway, we're excited to be talking about the challenger, right? And I think when it comes to a Bible character that we can fit into this category or this personality type, there's a lot of them that are certainly available to us. But we're going to talk about Samson a little bit, because Samson was someone who really gives us the good, the bad, and the ugly of an eight. And I don't know about you, but I'm thankful for God as He was giving us the Bible. Giving us as the Bible was being formed, like I could see some maybe having the thought, why don't you just put all the good in there about these great people in the Bible who did amazing things, and that would be cool, right? But I'm not sort of thankful. I'm very thankful that when the Bible gives us these Bible characters and talks about these great men and women of God of old, It shows us both the good and the bad. It shows us the highs and the lows. And with Samson, we see this. On one end, he is this this high justice and compassionate type person who gets in there and really whips up on Philistines with the jawbone of a donkey. This guy did some amazing things, was just serving as a judge over Israel in his day, killed a lion with his bare hands, just some amazing stories of just defending and protecting his people from the tyranny of the Philistines at that time. And yet we see in a moment of weakness, he falls for this lady Delilah, right, and shares with her, which is one of the hardest things for a challenger to do, is to make themselves vulnerable. He becomes vulnerable to this woman and shares with him the secret of his strength, and it ends up costing him dearly as the Philistines come in, gouge out his eyes, cut his hair, and his life at that point seemed like it was over. And I could see that for a Samson, man, there would be this guilt that is there of ultimately failing in this job of serving as a judge over Israel in that day. But as a seven, he's in the presence of all these Philistines at this party, and instead of trying to preserve himself, he puts his hands on the columns of that temple that day, and he knows what he's about to do is going to cost his own life. But he knows in taking out these Philistines and all of these leaders, that it's going to help his people. And so to bring justice to his people and help to his people, he basically goes out a martyr that day. And that is the heart of a seven, that is truly willing to lay their own self down whenever they see others that are hurting or in a bad way. For eights, the spiritual formation is something that can be challenging at times, right? Because they're tempted with this, on one hand, this lust for power and control, and yet there's always this desire in them to help to bring justice to those that are hurting. But eights need to understand that the Spirit of Christ wants to transform this lust for power or control they might have into their life to a fruit of love, gentleness, and self-control in their life. Some things that come easy for an eight in terms of spiritual growth or spiritual strengths is that of course, justice and compassion. They're energized by the ability or the opportunity to contend for the common good. Micah 6:8 would probably be their mission in life, to love justice and to do mercy. This is the heart of an eight. They're filled with compassion for the underdog, if you will. But some things that are perhaps spiritually challenging for them are things like accountability, because eights tend to avoid vulnerability. Right? So for them, accountability is very tough. Letting others get too close, because they're afraid if they do, others might want to control them or might not like them, is very, very difficult for an eight. Confession is also difficult for an eight for some of the same reasons, because many times it's not enough for them to be surrounded by people. They don't allow themselves to go further in that and to reveal themselves, as I said before, to become vulnerable or accountable through confessing maybe things that they've done wrong or weaknesses that they have in their life. So they could learn a lot from James 5:16 that calls upon us to confess our sins one to another, that we might be healed. Eights at their worst can become, if they get hurt or if they're in danger at their worst, they can become very vengeful type people, and at times even destroy, become self-destructive and destroy everything around them. But at their best, they are truly courageous people, willing to put themselves out there and put themselves even in serious jeopardy, just like we saw with Samson, to achieve their vision and lasting influence. And many eights achieve true heroism in life and even historical greatness. A lot of historically great people are eights who really strove to make a difference in this world. Bible reference for eights that Kristen mentioned, 2 Corinthians 12, I think is great. So to keep me from becoming conceited, because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given to me in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. Now you say, well, how is that great? Well, I think it's a great reminder for us that we've got to stay humble and we have to stay dependent upon God. We can't be dependent upon our own strengths, but we have to put our dependency upon God if we are going to be successful in this life, and especially for eights who like to challenge that process. Remember that ultimately God is in control, and you can't always fix everything. But you can do what God has called you to do in the moment and be content with that. So let's have a word of prayer as we close out today. God, we love you and we thank you for your goodness in our lives. We thank you for apes who are challengers, challenge the process, challenge the injustices of this world. And God, we know that within each side of us, there is a little or a lot of this eight type of personality. God, would you help us all to become the best version of this in our life? And Father, I pray that just like so many of the great Bible figures that we read about, Lord, that we would be willing to confront the injustices of this world with a great compassion, no matter the cost. When you've called us to do it, let us be bold in our pursuit of tackling injustices in this world. God, we love you and we thank you for your greatness and your goodness in our life, in your strong and mighty name. Amen. Bless you guys. We'll see you next time.